Still in our covenant season of purpose, and one of the things that we want to thank God for is that he started with us very powerfully last month, September, on the theme of vision and how important it is for you to have a vision. Vision drives everything. The Bible says where there is no vision, the people perish. We need vision to be able to run your life. You need vision to be able to connect to the things for which God has established your life. And this particular month, we are looking at different aspects of God manifesting in you, achieving purpose. And today, the theme of our week starts with positioning for divine intervention. So the title of my message is Positioning for Divine Intervention. We have a banner here today that simply shows us. The banner is showing a hand that is above, reaching out to a hand that is below. That is just a simple way of showing how you and I need that hand that is above every time. You need that hand to lift you from where you are. Hallelujah. And this week, what God wants to do is to show you how he's willing to lift you from your current level to where he wants you to be. In this, your season of higher levels, you will be rightly positioned for divine intervention. In the mighty name of Jesus. This particular picture reminds me of the great servant of God, Peter, the apostle. The Bible says that concerning him, that a time came, he saw Jesus in Matthew chapter 14 and other gospel texts. And like the other disciples, they said, it is not, who is he? It's a spirit. And Jesus in Matthew 14, 27 said to them, he said, it is not I, do not be, it is I, do not be afraid, it is I. And Peter, with all his audacity, said, Lord, if it is you, bid me to come, to walk on the water as you are walking on water. And as Peter, and God, Jesus said to Peter, come. Peter stepped out and he began to walk on the water. But a time came, in verse 29, the Bible says he saw the wind boisterous. And verse 30, the Bible says, as soon as he saw the wind boisterous, he began to say, Lord, save me. That is to say, Lord, I need divine intervention. I was operating the supernatural just now, but I lost position. I lost my faith. I lost my focus. Help me. And you and I must always know that our life is always needing to cry out for this divine intervention from time to time. Don't let any happening of God in your life become so ordinary that you forget to ask God for divine intervention continuously. And so this week, our emphasis will be to look at this very important aspect of life and how God wants us to rely on him for divine intervention. And I believe it shall be your portion in Jesus' name. Everyone who is in pursuit of purpose will always require divine intervention. Every God-given task that God has given to you and the things that God has called you to do will need the work you are doing, but it will also need the help of God. You cannot be everywhere every time. You cannot do everything every time. There are times that you sleep, but there is a God that does not sleep nor slumber. That you sleep doesn't mean that the world has stopped. That you sleep doesn't mean that evil has stopped working. That you sleep doesn't mean that, you know, everything else has gone to bed. As a matter of fact, when you sleep, many other things are just waking up. And they are orchestrated by the demonic forces of this world to try to make life miserable for you. But thank God for the intervention of the divine that helps us even whilst we are asleep, even whilst we are not in the consciousness of who we are. I pray over your life today that you will continue to enjoy divine intervention. In the name of Jesus. So this divine intervention requires what I call proper positioning. God is interested in where we are. God wants you to always position yourself spiritually and physically. Tell your neighbor for me, spiritual positioning and physical positioning. This was why in the Garden of Eden, when the first man was created, the Bible says, and God will come down in the cool of the day, and he will come and have a fellowship with man. And a time came when man sinned, and he went and hid himself. God asked man a question for the first time. In Genesis chapter 3, from verse 8 and verse 9, the Bible says, when they hid themselves, the Lord God called out to Adam and said to him, where are you? These three words are very significant. If you want to see God, you need to be asking, you need to be allowing God to ask you this question every time, and you must have an answer for him. He said, Adam, where are you? I have come in the cool of the day to enjoy my fellowship with you as usual. The Bible says in verse 8, and they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees in the garden. Then the Lord God called Adam and said to him, where are you? Ask your neighbor for me, where are you? Spiritually, physically. Now, I know that physically, all of us are here now. I can see you, you can see me. But the truth of the matter is that spiritually, only God knows where everybody is. Physically, you may be in a place, but the truth is, for you to connect to what God is doing in any place, you must be there spiritually and physically. Adam was spiritually, was physically in the garden, but he was already spiritually disconnected. God, who knew all things, God, who created him, had to be asking, Adam, where are you? I can't find you. I know you are in the garden physically, but I can't find you. This is a type of where man is when man does not understand the importance of spiritual connection and physical connection happening all the time. And so we must understand that spiritual positioning means that our heart is consistently connected to God, reliant on God and on his word. This is the most important thing. There was a time a prophet or a seer, as the King James Version calls him, called Hanani, came to a king called Asa. And in 2 Chronicles chapter 16 verse 7, the Bible says, Hanani came and spoke to Asa. Let's read it together. And at that time, Hanani, read it with me, the seer came to Asa, king of Judah, and said to him, because you have relied on the king of Syria and have not relied on the Lord your God, therefore the army of the king of Syria has escaped from your hand. And then he continued to say, verse 8, read it with me, were the Ethiopians and the Lubim not a huge army with very many chariots and horsemen? Yet, because you relied on the Lord, he delivered them into your hand. Because you relied on the Lord, he delivered them into your hand. When you relied on the king of Syria and did not rely on the Lord, he escaped. But when you faced the Ethiopians and the Libyans, the Bible says they were a huge army with very many chariots of horsemen. But because you relied on the Lord, he delivered them into your hand. You had divine intervention when you relied on God. You had the help of God when you relied on God. When your mind is not focused completely on the things of God, you are indirectly relying on the things that are not of God. Your life and my life must constantly rely on God. This was what the prophet was saying to Asa. He said, because, verse 9, which we always quote, and I want us to read it out loud. For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong. Somebody say divine intervention. To show himself strong on who? on behalf of those whose heart is what? Loyal to him. In this you have done foolishly. Therefore, from now on, you shall have wars. You will not have wars. I say you will not have wars. Because you will not do foolishly. In the name of Jesus. You and I must understand that the place of reliance on God is a lifetime and perpetual lifestyle. Isaiah chapter 26 verse 3. He said, you will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is what? Stayed on you. Because what? He trusts in you. Verse 4 says, trust in the Lord. How long? Read it with me. Trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord. When it is good. Trust in him when you have money. Trust in him when the wife is happy. Or the husband is jolly. Trust in the Lord forever. For in Yah, the Lord is what? Everlasting strength. If you want his everlasting strength, your trust must be forever. There is no up and down with God. There is no today connection, tomorrow not connection. There is no way you can gain divine intervention continuously if your mind is not stayed on the Lord. There is every pressure in life that the enemy brings our way that attempts to make us waver. This is a call to consistent and enduring reliance on God and on his word. I pray that that grace will come upon you today. In the name of Jesus. Our generation is materialistic. Highly materialistic. Probably the most materialistic generation ever. Simply because the options of materialism and the things that surround us are vast and much more in abundance than ever before. So there is a mad rat race where people are chasing things instead of chasing God. And unfortunately, Christians are also caught up in the same rat race. Now, there is nothing wrong in taking responsibility for life and wanting to get the things of life. But Jesus made it so simple. He said, as far as the things you need are concerned, your heavenly Father knows that you need them. He knows. He has never changed. People have always needed clothes. That's why even when they were going through the wilderness and there will be no tailors and there will be no factories to produce cotton and produce fabric, he supernaturally gave them clothes that could not wear out. He knew they would need shoes. So he gave them shoes that no human being has ever been able to recreate. Shoes that you wore from age 1 to age 40. And it kept on growing with your legs. Growing with your legs. It's kind of scary, isn't it? Somebody said divine intervention. Now that God has not changed. Why do we think that the God we read that delivered the Egyptians, the Israelites from the Egyptians, is not the same God? That God has not changed. He has no plans to change. The Bible says he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. You need a childlike faith to believe that whatever you have seen him do in time past, he is able to do again. It's as simple as that. Again and again and again. So you must be reliant on God. Don't let the pressure of this world make your heart waver. The Bible says, Abraham staggered not at the promises of God. Now, I want you to look at the life of Abraham very well. And if you understand his life and how God will qualify him as somebody who did not stagger at the promises of God, you will understand what God means when he says that you do not waver. Is it not the same Abraham that told the king that his wife was his sister? Of course, he was kind of his half-sister, but he actually meant to deceive the king. Is it not the same Abraham? Is it not the same Abraham that agreed with Sarah and went into Hagar and had a child called Ishmael with Hagar? Is it not the same Abraham? It's the same one. Now, how will God now say that that kind of person is one who did not stagger at the promises of God? From that, I understand that it is not about a perfection. It is about the intention, about the motive, always wanting to do right, always wanting to make sure that you are standing with God and for God. Don't wait until you are perfect. Keep walking towards perfection. The Bible says every one of us, as we behold him, are being transformed continuously. So don't let the devil knock you down and say that you cannot trust God because your heart is not yet perfect. When he talks about those whose hearts are perfect and stayed on him, he's talking about those who have checked their motives, those who make sure that on a daily basis, nothing is taking their love of God away from them. Those who have made sure that they are standing for God regardless of what they fail. Even when they fall, they pick themselves up again and they say, Lord, I'm in it for the long haul. I pray that you will continue to stand for God like that. In the name of Jesus. God described David as a man after his own heart. Another wonderful human being. You know the story of David very well. I wouldn't say too much about it. But God said in 1 Samuel chapter 13, verse 14, through Samuel the prophet, when he was speaking to Saul, that David was a man after God's own heart, whom God has now sought to replace Saul. So David was divinely positioned for intervention continuously. Look at what he said in Psalm 89. Psalm 89 verse 20. He said, I have found. Somebody say, God is looking for servants. God is looking for servants. Say, God is looking for servants. Now listen, when you say you found something, is it not that you intentionally were looking for it? You were looking for it? How many of you look for your car keys? And then at times you feel like dialing it on a phone as if you were looking for your mobile phone. And you wish that it will just come. It will ring somewhere. And it can be very frustrating. And when you find it, you are happy. You are excited. Because without finding that thing, you can't move. And so this is how God was excited. This is how God was rejoicing over the choice and the location of David. This is why I want you to know that in divine positioning, God will always be looking for you and I. I pray that we will be found where he looks for us. In the name of Jesus. He said, I have found David my servant. With my holy oil, I have anointed him. And then he began to say what he will do on his behalf. Verse 21. He said, With whom my hand shall be established, also my arm shall strengthen him. Somebody say divine strength. Verse 22, the enemy shall not outwit him. Somebody say divine deliverance. He said, nor the son of wickedness afflict him. Somebody say divine protection. So only one man who has been found in the divine providence of God is receiving all this divine intervention. He said, is David my servant? I have found him. I will strengthen his right arm. I will give him divine strength. I will make sure that the enemy does not outwit him. I will divinely protect him. I will make sure that the son of wickedness does not afflict him. I will divinely deliver him. The Bible says in verse 23. And then not only that, in verse 23, he said, I will beat down his foes before him. Somebody said, divine victory. This is why David was winning wars supernaturally. One man conquering 1,000 people is no mean feat. It's impossible in the physical. It's impossible. You and I must understand that certain battles that are ahead of us that we are trying to fight in the physical need the intervention of the divine. And until we secure it, it is a lifetime of frustration. You will not be frustrated. I have understood that for a person to attain anything in life, he must be divinely supported. When God wants to place a man in a position, he unleashes every degree of favor. Every time I remember President Obama's election in 2008, I just see God in a dimension. From nowhere, this guy who was not known 10 years before, because God decided at that point in time that he wanted him, everybody, the man came to this country, and for the first time in over 100 years, both houses of parliament met to receive one man, something that had not happened in over 100 years, both the houses, the House of Lords and the House of Commons. they met to receive just that one man because of the oil that was upon him. Now listen to me. There are things that will happen in your life that even you will be wondering how you ever got there, because my God will divinely intervene on your behalf. In the name of Jesus, you must rely on divine intervention continuously so that the enemy that is before your face will continually be beaten down by your God. The Bible says, and he will plague those who hate you. I say he will plague those who hate you. In the name of Jesus. All you need to keep doing is to keep that perfect heart. That heart that has a motive to want to serve God. That heart has an intention to always want to do the things of God. And it will continue to be your portion. In the name of Jesus. So as we talk about the spiritual positioning of the heart, we must also understand that there is also the place of the physical. The process of receiving divine intervention also requires physical positioning, or what I call physical action, in order to activate its effect. There are several examples of scripture. We will not open to all of them. There was a time when Jesus as a baby, in Matthew chapter 2, verse 13, his life was being threatened by the wicked one, Herod, who was going to kill all the children born so that the Savior could be destroyed. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 2, if you read from verse 13 to 21, Joseph, his father, his earthly father, or the father who had parental care of him, was instructed by an angel to take the boy and flee to Egypt. Someone said divine intervention. And there had to be a physical relocation of the boy Jesus from Jerusalem right through to Egypt. Hallelujah. And this is very important. We must understand that there are physical steps we must take from time to time. Being in church physically is very different from having an e-church. Someone say e-church. E-church. You know what e-church is? Just watching on TV. It's a very different thing. There is a place of the physical, that there is something that you contact in the physical place that is very vital to seeing God manifest. This is why I laugh at people. I laugh in the sense that it is very funny at people when I hear things like, you know, Pastor, I know I should be going to that church. It doesn't have to be this church. But I hear people say things like, I know I should be going to church so, so and so. But somehow, because, you know, of what people will say and because of this and that, I just chose to remain where I am. I laugh because you have missed God. That you are physically in the wrong place means that you are where God is not. No matter the explanation you want to give to it, if God has said to you that is where you ought to go, you better move. Now there are people who, of course, by reason of what they do and by reason of certain things, it may be difficult. But whatever you do, I want you to understand that where you are supposed to be is where God wants to deal with you. This is why when he had to take the whole Savior of the world to Egypt, he documented it so that we understand that the security of the Savior was transferred to Egypt at that point in time. And that young boy Jesus had to be moved to Egypt for the temporary period until God came and spoke to them again and said, those that were seeking his life are now dead. I pray that you will always hear God to be in the right place. In the name of Jesus. Many people have not changed their jobs for long because they are afraid. What God is asking them to go into looks uncertain. But the truth is, if you hear God and he asks you to move and change jobs, you better don't waste your time. Someone say, keep moving when you need to move. I'm not asking you to go and resign your job. But I'm saying to you, if you need to change your job, then change it. Don't wait 1 minute. Whatever you need to change, the only thing you cannot change as you like is your spouse. Don't say, I'm tired of you. I'm changing. I'm changing today. Yo, you can't change that one. That one is impossible. But any other thing, you can change your job, you can change your house, you can change your car, you can change anything. When you are tired of something, you change it. I used to have a very faithful car. Got it from brand new. It served me very well. Very, very lovely car. And I liked it. But one day I said, I think we need to part ways. You have done a lot for me and I'm very grateful. But we need to part ways. So I let it go. Praise the Lord. You need to always understand that spiritually speaking, there is a place you ought to be and there are steps you ought to take. There was a time in 2 Kings chapter 6 from verse 1 when the sons of the prophet were with Elisha and one of them borrowed an axe and they were making a place. The Bible says that the axe head fell into the water. And the servant, the prophet, son of the prophet, shouted out to Elisha. He said, "Alas, master, the axe has fallen into the water, for it was what? Borrowed." And God used Elisha to rescue the situation by cutting a branch and throwing it in the water. And the axe head floated. And the man was able to pick it again. Somebody say divine intervention. This is how God will make sure that you will never be embarrassed. I say you will never be embarrassed. That man was seeing embarrassment looming in his face. What will I tell the person who loaned me the axe? What will I say to them? How will I tell them that I don't have the axe anymore? He was already having all those questions in his heart. But God saved him from embarrassment. I say you'll be saved from every embarrassment. As you openly let God have his way, you will be saved from every embarrassment. In the name of Jesus. There are several other stories. We can't go into all of them. We know the woman with the issue of blood. She was healed as she stepped out in bold action. Luke chapter 8, verse 43 to 45. The crossing of the Red Sea. Moses was saved from embarrassment and death because the people would have died and perished under the claws of Pharaoh and his cohort. But he heeded divine instruction, lifted up his rod, and the waters parted hither and thither. Exodus chapter 14. Verse 15 and 16. But the time came after that deliverance. In Exodus chapter 15, they came to a place they were needing water. And the Bible says Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea. Exodus chapter 15, verse 25. Exodus chapter 15, verse 22 to 25. The Bible says, read it with me very quickly. So Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea. Then they went out into the what? The wilderness of Shur. And they went 3 days in the wilderness and found no water. If you've gone for 3 days without water, you know how famished you will feel. So they were very thirsty. And of course, in their typical fashion, verse 24, and the people, what? Complained. They forgot about the deliverance of the Red Sea. They forgot about the miracle of all the plagues. They forgot everything that had happened in time past. The Bible says, and they did what? They complained against Moses, saying, "What shall we drink? What shall we drink?" Verse 25, read it with me. So he cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a tree. When he cast it into the waters were what? Made sweet. Somebody say divine intervention. Say divine intervention. The waters were made sweet. There he made a what? A statute and an ordinance for them. And there he tested them. May the Lord continue to find us faithful. In every testing of life, may the Lord continue to find us a faithful people. In the name of Jesus. Friends, you need to identify the things that always try to frustrate your faith. Identify them. It may be pressure of work. There are certain people, if business is not going well, you just suddenly find a different person. Some people, if money is in their account, if you see them on payday, they are wonderful, loving. Everybody around them enjoys them. But 1 week after payday, they are grouchy again for the rest of the month. There are some people, if they hear certain kind of things, some news of something, a bereavement, and things like that, it takes them over completely. And you will be surprised. You need to identify the things that the enemy uses to make you disconnect and to make you lose your positioning in God and submit them to God and ask God for grace so that you can always be somebody who will always rely on God and will not be disappointed in his doings. The Lord will continue to stand for you. in the name of Jesus. This was how Rebecca also, by divine positioning, got her husband. We read her story in Genesis chapter 24, from verse 13 to 15. The Bible says, when the servant of Abraham got to the waters, he said, "Behold, I stand by the well of water, and the daughters of men of the city are coming out." So there were many ladies coming out to draw water. Verse 14 says, "Now let it be that the young woman to whom I say, 'Please let down your pitcher that I may drink.'" And he says, and she says, "Drink, and I will also give your camels a drink. Let her be the one you have appointed for your servant Isaac. And this I will know that you have shown kindness to my master." Verse 15. The Bible says, "And it happened before he had finished speaking." Someone said, divine positioning. While he was just saying those things, God moved Rebekah to the right place. That behold, read verse 15 with me. "And it happened before he had finished speaking, that behold, Rebekah, who was born to Bethuel, son of Milcah, the wife of Nahor, Abraham's brother," just like Abraham wanted a person from his clan. "And it so happened that she came out with her pitcher on her shoulder." You will walk into divine destiny. I say you will walk into divine destiny. When they are making considerations of something that is important and they just need somebody to show up, you will show up. I say you will show up in the name of Jesus. This one that you hear news that, "Oh, if only you were there, you would have been considered." It will never be your portion again. I say it will never be your portion again. In the name of Jesus. Wherever you need to be part time so that your allocation can reach you, my God will locate you there. In the name of Jesus. You will hear the voice of the one behind you saying, "This is the way, walk in it. This is the place, stay there. And it shall be your portion." In the name of Jesus. Friends, I submit to you, I, by God's grace, I'm a benefactor of divine positioning. I've enjoyed divine intervention. I enjoy divine intervention virtually every day of my life. And there are some remarkable testimonies that I have. I shared one testimony with you about how many, many years ago, when I was just getting into university and my results was not released for me to be able to go in. Now, I got into university at a very, very young age. I had just finished a secondary school, but I got into direct entry into the university. But that meant that I needed to I was given an admission on the basis of my first, what we used to call the mock results. And that meant that by the time I was registering finally, I had to provide or produce my final results. Now, somehow, as an engineering student, my physics result was not released. And those days, you must have maths, you must have physics, and you must have chemistry among your minimum five subjects that you've passed. Every other subject was passed very well. Somehow, my physics result was withheld. And there is no day I am privileged to do anything as a professional engineer today by the grace of God. Anything of significance, addressing conferences and congresses across the world by God's privilege today, that I don't remember that if not by divine intervention, I would not have been an engineer at all. I would not have been able to continue my engineering studies. And so I went to the place where I needed to collect my results. And I saw a load of people who had come from all over the country. This is in Lagos, southern Nigeria. And loads of people who were there, I never imagined that they came for the same thing I came for. I assumed that, you know, there are times that when you see many people, you say, no, they cannot be the same thing that I'm looking for. My own case is different. And then I suddenly found that every other person there was also looking for the same thing. And some of them had spent 2 weeks, and I needed just 3 more days to produce that result. Otherwise, I'd lose my admission. And I went into the place, and somebody said to me, "The only thing you can do now is to go and pay. And when you pay, you submit the application, and then you come back. You go and come back. There's nothing you can do." And I did that, and I just was confused. I was 15 going on 16. I was very young. It was my first time in Lagos, as a matter of fact, the very first time. And so everything was very, very daunting for me. And I remember, after paying, God led me to the divine location. Somebody say divine location. I went and I sat down in the front of a door that I never knew was an orchestration of God for where I needed to be for my matter to be resolved. And as I sat down there, not knowing what to do, the door behind me opened. And a woman walked out. And she said to me, "Young man, what are you doing here? People are not allowed here." I said, "I'm sorry, ma'am. I didn't know I should not sit here. I'm just confused. I just didn't know what to do." And she looked at me. And somehow, this angel of a person became my deliverance. She said to me, "So what can I do for you?" I said, "Ma'am, this is it. I need my result and I need to be back in the university in a few days' time. And I'm told that it takes about 3 weeks. I'm going to lose my admission." She said to me, have you paid?" She said, "Yes." "Do you have your receipt?" I said, "Yes." She collected it. And then she took it. She saw it and she collected it. She said, "Have you done your application?" She said, "Yes." She said, "Okay. Give me your paperwork." He said, "Tomorrow by 10 a.m., come to this very place." She said, "Don't go through the other door. Come to this very place. Don't ask for anybody. Just come here and knock on this door once. And then that is it." I said, "Ma'am, thank you very much. God bless you." I never knew I was speaking to the registrar, the person who was responsible for signing off all the final results before they are issued. I did not have a clue. So when I left, I told my cousin who I was staying with what happened. He said, "You better go there. Maybe God is helping you." So the next day, I went back. Trust me, I was there by 9 a.m. 9 a.m., I was stood in front of that magical door, waiting for 10 a.m. Because she told me, "Don't knock before 10. When it is 10, just knock once." So immediately it was 10 a.m., I hit the door once. Thank you. And as if it was a film show before me, she opened the door, as she had said, handed me a sealed brown envelope, and said, "That is your result. Take it to your university. Don't open it, because if you open it, it will become invalidated. It will become invalid. And so don't open it. Take it to your university. But I can tell you, you passed your physics." I held it. I was shaking. I said, "Thank you, ma. God bless you." She said, "Just go away. Just go away. Just go away." And I left the place as if it was a dream. I did not show anybody on the queue. I hid my result and left the place. This was how I registered today. And until today, God helped me through university. Praise the Lord. What the enemy was planning to use to stop me, God divinely positioned me in a place that will give me a testimony. It is one of the most remarkable things that has ever happened in my life. I never set my eyes on that angel of a woman again, ever. But she allowed me to get the first degree, which led to the second degree and the third degree in engineering today by the grace of God. Wherever you need to be part-time, my God will put you there. Amen. I say, wherever you need to be divinely located, my God will put you there. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. The day we were to get this building, it was a supernatural intervention. God knew that we did not have any credit history as an organization. He knew that if it was to go through the agents that were responsible, we would not have been accredited. We would not have been credit worthy. Because the first thing they say is, "Give your first year audited accounts," and you are just starting. You don't even have one account. Not to talk of audited one. So God made sure that when my wife came here to look at the property, I asked her to go and look at, she met the landlord himself, who was willing to accept us without any credit history, without any record whatsoever. Somebody say divine intervention. Friends, everything called frustration in your life, I decree from today, my God will end them all. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Amen. You will find God responding to you in the times that you never knew what was going to happen. In the mighty name of Jesus, it shall be your portion. In Jesus' mighty name. Two things you should do. Keep your heart clean all the time. Be sensitive to the Holy Spirit all the time. And it shall be well with you. In Jesus' name. Give the Lord a big hand. He's worthy. He's faithful. Hallelujah.